Today is the day of our salvation. Mm-hmm. I pray that you will help each one of us to see the unseen, to look beyond what we see, to that which you want us to see. Mm-hmm. Father, we've lost our clothes. We're naked. We stand before you naked. But you want to clothe us. You want to purify us. You want us to reflect your character, your image. You are willing to bring us to that point, to that place. I pray that we will humble ourselves today. Seek your face, surrender our hearts to you so that you can pour that power into our lives to receive the blessings and the restoration that you want to give. Amen. Teach us now in the way of your Holy Spirit and your word, and I thank you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So there was made mention of my clothes today. And I hesitated to put these clothes on. Number one, because I made them. They're not perfect. I don't even like them. You know, when you make something, you want it to be perfect, don't you? You want others to like it. When God calls us to be pure, to be purified, to become primitive in our godliness, he's calling us to come out of what we may think is all right into something that is better, that is perfect, that is glorious, and that also, when we're referring to our clothes, referring to his righteousness. Do we want to, like in Revelation, portray the whore? do we want to portray the pure church? In our dress, the outward appearance points us to what is above. And isn't that what God is calling us to with primitive godliness? He's saying you need a total transformation as well as a reformation, a revival and a reformation. So when you hear the word, you read the word, you hear the word, and then you try to practice it, are you perfect? You're perfect in that sphere. And every day, as we walk, we become more perfect. More perfect. My perfection is not your perfection. Your perfection. Everyone has different levels of understanding. Hearts, each of our hearts. And hopefully, each day and each moment, God is softening our hearts. We're allowing Him to soften our hearts so that He can give us the truth, and we can receive it, and He can mold us. If it's hard, and we don't want to hear it, He is not going to force His way in. Not at all. So, though this garment, these garments that I made are not perfect, when I wear them, I begin to see the imperfections. And probably everyone, maybe not everyone, that has that eye, can see the imperfections. So as I was putting on this coat, I love the material, I love the color, but as I walk, I notice, do you notice anything about the sleeves?
One is longer than the other.
One is a little longer, the left one. Okay, yeah, I noticed that today too. Oh man, sloppy, a little sloppy. Where should it go? Where should my sleeve go? About here is a good length. Mm-hmm. Okay, and what about the shoulders?
It's mm-hmm.
A little sloppy again. Yeah, they're not right. Would you want me to teach you how to sew?
Yes.
What I'm trying to say, and I've been sewing for over 40 years, my daughter, she's not that old. She started sewing. She could sew so much better than me. Oh, I was just so excited. Oh, good. In fact, she made a dress one time. It was for her. But guess what? It was too big. She goes, Mom, here. Oh, thank you so much. In our learning experience, we're not perfect. We hear the perfect word. We try to apply it to our life, but we're not perfect. And so, when you're composing something, you're writing something, and you hand it over to someone to edit it, what do?
Mark it up.
Well, they mark it up. Yes. And give it back, and you rewrite it where it needs to be rewritten, right? Today, if you are given correction or reproof, how do you take it? How's your heart? Is it hard or is it soft? I know my heart can be hard sometimes. Oh, I just want it to be this way. And then I have to pray, Father in heaven, give me that heart, your heart. We don't always like correction. We don't always like reproof, but God's doing it. And I'm so thankful that my daughter, I could see that she could write well. And so as she would write, you know, then we would edit together. And so that reproof, that correction began it to be received more readily, because you can see that with the reproof and the correction, you do better. You become more perfect. Of course, the correction is not always done the way we like it. This person could say it a little different, a little better. We're going to look at how God was correcting someone who did something really bad. And if you turn in your Bibles to 2 Samuel. I make notes on these. 2 Samuel chapter 12. Let's look there. Let me get to this couple of slides first before we get into that. Bring man before the true mirror. How many of you looked in the mirror this morning? Well, that's it?
Yeah.
I hope we all did. And especially the young. I mean, they really, you know, we've got to have every hair in place. We get older, we just know hair's not going to stay in place. Mm-hmm. Anyhow, I've never been able to figure out how to do my hair, so. Anyhow, we have examples of men of debased morals who have been brought before the law of God, the true mirror. The law of God, the true mirror. In it, they have seen the defects of their character, and when pointed to the atoning blood of a crucified Redeemer, they accepted it as their only hope. They were truly converted. From this time, their life has changed. They have not a sensational religion. Most of what I have gotten from regarding primitive godliness has been from the Great Controversy. The canisters have gotten out many great controversies recently.
Yes.
Some canisters haven't read the Great Controversy. But we need to get in it, right? It'll help us tremendously. Chapter 27 of Great Controversy is Modern Revivals. Modern Revivals talks about the true and the false coming before the true. And we've had a lot of sensational religion. In the last probably 25 years or so, how many of you heard of celebration churches? Celebration, yeah. That caused a lot of turmoil. And we still have celebration songs and music. Anyhow, do you want a sensational religion or do you want a true religion? Let's go to David. David sinned. David sinned. He transgressed the law of God. A prophet of God was sent to reprove him and convict him of his error. So let's take a look at how that conviction went down. And if we could start reading 2 Samuel chapter 12. Who has a Bible? Okay, let's start over here. And if you have a Bible, you go ahead and read the next verse.
So we're starting at verse 1?
1,
Go ahead. And the Lord sent Nathan unto David, and he came unto him and said unto him, there were two men in one city, the one rich and the other poor.
Okay, before we go to the next verse, it says, and the Lord sent who?
Nathan.
Who's Nathan?
The prophet.
So where do we go to find out about whether or not we're sinning?
God.
Through his word and
the
prophet. Prophet. God sent him a prophet. Do we have a prophet today? This is the pattern of how we are to study to know God. From the Bible, spirit of prophecy. That's our modern day prophet, the spirit of prophecy, Ellen White. Okay, so in that first verse, we see the Lord sent Nathan unto David. All right, verse 2.
The rich man had exceeding many flocks and herds. But the poor man had nothing save one little ewe lamb, which he had bought and nourished up, and it grew up together with him and with his children. It did eat of his own meat and drank of his own cup and lay in his bosom and was unto him as a daughter.
Wow, that powerful verse.
Mm-hmm.
So simple, so precious. What do you think it was doing to David's heart? He didn't understand it exactly. Okay, verse 4.
And there came a traveler unto the rich man, and he spared to take of his own flock and of his own herd to dress for the wayfaring man that was come unto him, but took the poor man's lamb and dressed it for the man that was come to him.
because he had no pity.
And Nathan said to David, Thou art the Lord. Thus said the Lord God of Israel, I anointed thee king over Israel, and I delivered thee out of the hand of Saul.
And I gave thee thy master's house and thy master's wives unto thy bosom, and gave thee the house of Israel and of Judah. And if that had been too little, I would moreover have given unto thee such blessing and such thing.
What did you do? What did you do? Is it the work for the Lord by doing what is evil in his eyes? You struck down Uriah the Hittite with a sword and took his wife to be your own. You killed him with a sword of the Ammonite.
Now therefore the sword shall never depart from thine house, because thou hast despised me, and hast taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be thy wife.
Thus saith the Lord, Behold, I will raise up evil against thee out of thine own house, and I will take thy wives before thine eyes, and give them unto thy neighbor, and he shall lie with thy wives in the sight of the sun.
For thou didst it secretly, but I will do this thing before all Israel and before the sun.
And 13.
And David said unto Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said unto David, The Lord also hath put away thy sin, thou shalt not die.
Wow.
Wow, that's right. Okay, well, we could go on, but we're not going to. So God sent Nathan the prophet to speak to David, and instead of just directly exposing to David his sin, he wanted the illustration, the story, to go into his heart, and the Holy Spirit convict him. And when he was convicted of his sin, what did he do? He repented. I'm sorry. It was a repentance, sorrowful repentance. But there were still consequences, right? Still terrible consequences. God doesn't want us to have to experience those consequences. And so he reproves. He wants us to be reproved and corrected as we read his word. As we read it, and the Spirit of God touches our heart and wants us to be changed. And he will have a people that allow him to do that. But if you don't personally, individually study his word, he will have a hard time transforming us.
Something that I think is really powerful here is oftentimes, like what Ashwin was sharing at prayer meeting, we think that, well, we'll have that faith in due time and everything. But here we see that right in the instant, it says, David says, it shows that he has actual penitence in his heart. And as soon as he had that, Nathan says, it's already been put away because you have that reaction.
Yes, you're not going to die. God doesn't want us to die. He doesn't want us to perish. But still, many people were going to have to die because of the consequences of his sin. His own sons. Sin is a terrible thing. And so we want to, as we read his word, we want to ask him to take our hearts. Give us a new heart. We need a new heart in order to accept what he's saying. And many times it comes from the pulpit, maybe read from the Bible and Spirit of Prophecy, but we don't see it. We don't understand it. We must go back until we have the conviction. And we see that David did right there, right away. But there's a lot of distrust in our hearts today, a lot of hardness. He did not sing affecting songs, nor tell touching stories, but he brought before before David an illustration of his own course in a figure, parable-like, and let him pass sentence upon himself. Then he said, "Thou art the man." David repented and found pardon through Christ. And thus it must be with the sinner now. He must realize the enormity of his sin before he can exercise true repentance and experience a thorough conversion.
Wow.
The enormity of his sin. We're told about the people of God today in this solemn, antitypical Day of Atonement. They will be sighing and crying for the abominations done, yes, in the land, but also in our own lives. Sighing and crying, and then, hopefully that's done in the closet, many times it's done publicly, but then we can get up full of joy because our sins are forgiven. And be there for people who, like us, are going through similar sins. Similar transgressions. May we have pity, may we have that humbleness, that compassion, that tenderness also with those who don't know or don't understand what God is calling us to, that primitive godliness. I hope that we're all praying for it. That was written in 1875. And now modern revivals again. The light which flames up for a time soon dies out. Popular revivals too often excite the emotions, gratifying the love for what is new and startling. Converts thus gained have little desire to listen to Bible truth. Unless a religious service has something of a sensational character, it has no attraction for them. A revival of primitive godliness. Before the final visitation of God's judgments upon the earth, there will be among the people of the Lord such a revival of primitive godliness as not been witnessed since apostolic times. The enemy of souls desires to hinder this work, and before the time for such a movement shall come, he will endeavor to prevent it by introducing a counterfeit. In those churches which he can bring under his deceptive power, he will make it appear that God's special blessing is poured out. It will be manifest what is thought to be great religious interest. And that can happen to you. It can happen to me. Many years ago, I was going to a lot of camp meetings, and just charged up the music, and it wasn't the real rock Christian music. It was conservative Christian music, because that goes right in, the music does, just right in and can pump you up. And that's when I had to find out about deceptions that were in my own life that I wasn't aware of. It actually came from the pulpit, came from not nominal, but conservative camp meetings. Really drove me, actually God helped to get me in a place where I had time to study. I don't know if you have time to study. Even in the country, we can be so busy, we don't have time to study for ourselves. And so I spent 7.5 years in a place where I had to work 8 hours a day, but in the evenings, my evenings were totally mine. And I started studied. I did a lot of studying in those 7.5 years, and I had bookshelves full of notebooks that I had put together in my study. And it's always been my desire not to be too busy, and God, through my sickness 33 years ago, He trained me to not do anything past 5 o'clock, not start anything new, but just begin to wind down, go to sleep, and get up early. So if He wakes me up at 1 in the morning, okay, this is the time, and I'll study for 3 or 4 hours, and that's not even enough. And or two, whatever time it is, I like to wake up refreshed. How many people have a hard time waking up in the morning? Sometimes 7, 8, 9, still, it's hard to wake up. I don't like that. I spent years being tired at work, and that's the terrible thing. So anyhow, the Lord taught me, He trained me through the laws of health, how to get well, how to spend the hours before midnight, getting double the rest. And so I've been trained that way. Studying God's Word. I used to listen to a lot of sermons. And where I went, during those 7.5 years, we couldn't listen while we worked. We couldn't listen to sermons or anything. And so I learned, once again, to get in study for myself. And I learned so much in those 7.5 years. So much because of the study that I was doing. And that's what changes us, is the Word. If we're studying it to be changed. We're studying it just for knowledge, so we can go and answer all the questions, you know, in Sabbath school or prayer meeting or wherever it is or happening. No, it's to know God. To know Him, to have an experience with Him, to commune with Him. So that when He speaks to your heart, maybe it's through someone. I remember being here at each place. That's what ladies do. More emotional, I guess. But I had someone come up to me here at UT Pines and say, "Oh, I can see through your dress." Oh, well. You know, when someone says something to correct you, just, but with the Spirit of God, He softens your heart. Do I need to make something of my dress so He can't see through it? I was telling God this. What does He do? He sends me someone here at UG Pines, staff member, and she says, could you make me, I don't know if you men know, but the underdress is called a slip. It's the foundation of a dress. She says, could you make me, I think it started out with 1. Then it was 6. Then it was 10 more. And to this person, that foundation was important. It may sound so silly. But our hearts are hard. And even those, especially the young people, they don't want to correct their friends. Because how do we correct them without them not liking us? When we're young, we want to look like everybody else. We don't want to stand out. Some people want to stand out. We want Jesus to stand out. We want His character to stand out.
Amen.
Jesus is coming soon. He may be coming really soon, but he may not too. Whether he comes soon or he doesn't come soon, you only have today. You only have today to meet him. He wants to know you. We can go to church. We can eat right. We can dress right. We can sound right. We can seemingly do everything right, but still have sin in our hearts. I've had people say, oh, Teresa, you look so holy. You're so holy. We're so filthy. We are filthy. But the closer you get to Jesus, the more you want to be, look like him. You want to sound like him. And people are going to think all kinds of things. Anyhow, here's consequences to our sin. Consequences. So, we want to spend time with Jesus. It's the only way that we can have primitive godliness today. So what seeds will I plant today? What will be the result? If you don't love the truth, if you don't love these seeds here, if you don't love planting, if you don't love working on the farm, speak to Jesus. What do you have to teach me? What do you have to teach me? Wherever you're working, wherever you are, he has many things to teach you if you can see beyond what you see. And so as you look at what I'm wearing and you make a judgment, oh, the sleeves are too long. Shoulders don't fit right. Too baggy. Today, everything is tight. Everything is so tight. But as I look at it, I say, yeah, I don't want to be a gazing stock. I don't want people to stumble looking at me going, oh, that's just so bad. I was thinking, I could make this shorter. It wouldn't look so. But I really like the dress part. So there's things that we like about ourselves, things we don't like, things we can change. Once again, it should all be based on what does God say, based on principle. And yes, he gives us the choice. I can choose the color. I can choose the fabric. I can choose. But once again, do I say to him, you know, is this right for me? So always going back to what does God say? What does God say? This may be the last day, I don't know. Next week we're going to have spring seminar, praise the Lord. A lot of people coming to that we want to be praying for. Praise the Lord that we can have that spring seminar. When we start back, I'm not certain what we're going to do as far as chapel, but we'll let you know. And we may continue with this if I'm asked to do it. I just have a few more slides. We have a few more minutes. The importance of follow-up. After a revival, where you're dealing with like evangelistic meetings and so forth, this is talking about the follow-up. As the result of the presentation of the truth in large congregations, a spirit of inquiry is awakened, and it is especially important that this interest be followed up by personal labor. And even canvassing, you find people that are really inquiring, have they have questions. It's the follow-up that's so important. Those who desire to investigate the truth need to be taught to study diligently the Word of God. We have many people coming to church every week, sitting on the pews, and they don't know how to study God's Word. Did you know that? They don't know how to study it. The golden moment is lost. The impressions made were not followed up. It would have been better had no interest been awakened, for when convictions have been once resisted and overcome, it is very difficult to impress the mind again with the truth. Critical. Timing is critical. Someone must help them to build on the sure foundation. At this critical time in their religious experience, how important it is that wisely directed Bible workers come to their help and open to their understanding the treasure house of God's Word. Amen. It's a treasure house. Do you find treasure there? Bible study. Between an uncultivated field and an untrained mind, there is a striking similarity. So when you look out there and you see that field uncultivated, it's like the mind when it's not being cultivated with God's word. And then you see the places where the tractor has come and cultivated that soil and it's getting it ready for the seed. The soil of the heart is the mind. The soil of the heart. So how many rocks do we have up here? How much is it like concrete? For especially the older ones who have been trained falsely, there's a whole lot of rocks. In the minds of children and youth, the enemy sows tears. And unless parents keep watchful guard, these will spring up to bear their evil fruit. Unceasing care is needed. Unceasing care is needed in cultivating the soil of the mind of the child and sowing it with the precious seeds of Bible truth. Sowing is a different kind of sowing, isn't it? Different kind of sowing. Children should be taught to reject trashy, exciting tales and to turn to sensible reading, which will lead the mind to take an interest in Bible story, history, and argument. Reading that will throw light upon the sacred volume and quicken the desire to study it is not dangerous but beneficial. I was driving with a young person this past week, and we were talking, and I was asking about what kind of books that person liked to read. And it was scary. And it's sad because it puts rocks in the mind, in the mind soil. And it takes away from this. But I could see that God was wanting, he wants to break up that rock, those rocks and that hard cement-like soil. And he wants to make this word of God interesting. That's what you want. What you desire, what you hunger for. And there's many things that can break that drawing power as we keep leaning back to the worldliness. It is impossible for the youth to possess a healthy tone of mind and correct religious principles unless they enjoy the perusal of the Word of God. And that's where the homes come in, the homes where the parents are spending time morning and evening. Evenings are to be, if you have a family, it's family time. Family time. It's not work time. That's why when I was getting well, it was after 5 o'clock, I don't start anything new. No, it's family time. This book contains the most interesting history, points out the way of salvation through Christ, and is their guide to a higher and better life. Most interesting history. When heavenly intelligences see that men are no longer permitted to present the truth, that's coming, the Spirit of God will come upon the children. Oh, this is beautiful. And they will do a work in the proclamation of the truth, which the older workers cannot do because their way will be hedged up. Are we preparing them? In the closing scenes of this earth's history, many of these children and youth will astonish people by their witness of the truth to the truth, which will be born in simplicity, yet with spirit and power. Only though if they're being trained to do that. Daniel was trained. His three friends were trained. Joseph was trained. They have been taught the fear of the Lord, and their hearts have been softened by a careful and prayerful study of the Bible. So this word softens the breaks up those rocks. We read it with the Spirit of God. It will help cultivate the hard hearts. The things that we love, the things that we like, that we should hate. It changes us. In the near future, many children will be endued with the Spirit of God and will do a work in proclaiming the truth to the world that at that time cannot well be done by the older members of the church. Our church schools are ordained by God to prepare the children for this great work. Here, children are to be instructed in the special truths for this time and in practical missionary work They are to enlist in the army of workers to help the sick and the suffering. Little children. Little children. I am thankful that when I was so sick and my little children were growing up, they didn't like helping. But I was the sick one. I was the very sick one. And so Kimberly learned medical missionary work in the home. Praise God. She learned many of the things that you're learning today here at UT Pines, not in the great depth and detail, but enough to help be a helper. Children can take part in the medical missionary work, and by their jots and tittles can help to carry it forward. By them, God's message will be made known and his saving health to all nations. Then let the church carry a burden for the lambs of the flock. Every church needs to be considering more than lambs of the flock. Let the children be educated and trained to do the service for God. We're thankful for UT Pines that there's so many families here that are learning how to do medical missionary work. And in our family Sabbath school that meets right here, the last 9 years, we have been hoping to educate parents on how to educate and train their little lambs. Love and loyalty to Christ are the spring of all true service. In the heart touched by his love, there is begotten a desire to work for him. Let this desire be encouraged and rightly guided. Whether in the home, the neighborhood, or the school, the presence of the poor, the afflicted, the ignorant, or the unfortunate should be regarded not as a misfortune, but as affording precious opportunities for service. And this whole week, the Ellies have been at a table with books at the front of UT Country Life. And it is every day that I've been there, every afternoon, and watching these, you know, some people just are barely walking, hardly get up the steps, but to see our LEs just like go with them, walk with them. Even Dr. Julie, she's walking, let's walk together, you know, she said to one of the customers. And it's just so beautiful. This is how God is teaching us how to be benevolent, how to be loving, how to be unselfish. In this work, as in every other skill is gained in the work itself, it's on-the-job training. Children are getting on-the-job training with their mothers and fathers in the home. And on-the-job training, it doesn't matter what it is that we have to do that is part of our character development. And it might be teaching us humility, might be teaching us knowledge of God in some way, temperance, patience, godliness, brotherly kindness, and charity. On the job training, it is by training in the common duties of life and in ministry to the needy and suffering that efficiency is assured. My father wasn't even a Christian, but he'd tell me, he'd say, "Teresa, you are so efficient." I mean, when I read it from God's word, I know that God was speaking through him. Without this, the best meant efforts are often useless and even harmful. It is in the water, not on the land, that men learn to swim. And isn't that where the people are? They're in the water. They're the sea of people. In the water, so you can swim with them, get them on the rock, Christ Jesus. And lastly, family, look upon the family circle as a training circle where you are preparing your children for the performance of their duties at home, in society, and in the church. Here's the Osario family out there in their garden. God's providence is the school. It is this in this life that we are to separate sin from us through faith in the atoning blood of Christ in this life. Our precious Savior invites us to join ourselves to him, to unite our weakness to his strength, our ignorance to his wisdom, our unworthiness to his merits. God's providence is the school in which we are to learn the meekness and lowliness of Jesus. The Lord is ever setting before us not the way we would choose, which seems easier and pleasanter to us, but the true aims of life. It rests with us to cooperate with the agencies which heaven employs in the work of conforming our characters to the divine model. None can neglect or defer this work, but at the most fearful peril to their souls. It's time now to work out our own salvation with fear and trembling. Let's pray. Dear Father in heaven, you have glories before us. You want us to experience the closest walk that anyone has ever experienced before on this earth at this time. As the troubles mount all around us, people dying, people sick, people in need, people praying for truth. How glorious it is. I think of Jesus on the cross and the thief who said, "Remember me." Oh, how much that meant to Jesus. I pray for each one, each student here, and each person hearing this message, that today we will fall on the rock and be broken. So that, Father in heaven, you can do mighty things with us. Whether we're a child, or a teenager, or in our 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, 80s, 90s, whatever age we are, you can use us to be a blessing to someone. Forgive our sins and help us to climb the ladder, to walk in the path, and to receive correction and reproof so that you can transform us. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
No, I'm walking.